All right, let's start our second session of the morning. And the next speaker is Luiz Chamon, talking about Graphon neural networks.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. So before I begin, let me just acknowledge that actually the work that I'm going to present is led by one of Luiz at Penn, together with my old PhD advisor, former PhD advisor, I don't know, old, he might not appreciate that, former PhD advisor, Alejandro Ribeiro. So let me jump right in with the main question that I want to tackle today, which is what happens if we train a graph neural network on the wrong graph? So to first make sense of this question and then answer it, I will sort of go through this roadmap of going from convolutional neural networks to graph neural networks, then to graphon neural networks, and then back. So let me start by explaining what I mean by this question, right, in the first place, and by revisiting how we get from convolutional neural networks to graph neural networks. Now, the idea of convolutional neural networks are these architectures that are quite well suited for processing image or audio data, because they display several desirable properties, right, on this domain, such as stability, translation invariance, good properties, good priors on features adapted to these underlying problem geometries. And a lot of these properties arise due to properties of the convolution on these sort of regular domains, right? But sometimes we find ourselves facing data that do not live on these regular domains. And that's the case, for example, with network data that we find in applications such as resource allocation in wireless communication networks, or decentralized controllers for flocking for swarms of agents, or even in recommendation systems where you can think of user preferences as living on a similarity graph, right, between the users. Now, just as feed-forward neural networks are not really well suited for studying images, for processing data, image data, regular convolutional neural networks are not really well suited in this context, which brings us to, you know, this idea of graph convolution. Now, graph convolution are defined essentially by replacing the regular convolution stride by one that is adapted to the underlying network. So for example, we would use the adjacency matrix or the Laplacian of the network in order to induce a linear operation that we will call the stride of our convolution. And we can define the convolution just as we did always by, you know, aggregating these different strides throughout our data, multiple strides throughout the data. Now, for certain particular choices of graphs, we even recover the classical convolution. So, you know, in a sense, you can think of graph convolutions as sort of a generalization of convolutions, regular convolutions, to these network settings. So how do we get from convolutional neural networks to graph neural networks? We just replace graph regular convolutions by graph convolutions. And that's the only thing we do. Now, the reason why graph convolutions are attractive is because in a certain way, they induce features that are adapted to the underlying network of our problem, right? In the similar way that, you know, regular convolutions induce these Fourier features in the regular case. Now, the role of the coefficients of the network is then to select and combine these features, right, in order to achieve the task of interest by filtering essentially the eigenmodes that are induced by this linear operator that we defined as the stride of our convolution. Now, depending on the gap between these features, these spectral feature, graph spectral features, they might be easier or harder to discriminate, right, on the underlying for the underlying task, which shows really the importance of us speaking over choosing that graph that induces this convolution properly for the specific application that we're trying to solve here. Right? Now, in practice, there are many reasons for us to believe that we will actually choose the wrong graph. And the reason for that is the first one is sort of because this graph is typically estimated from data, right? So we will, for example, use a covariance matrix that we estimate from data. So in that case, we actually get the wrong graph because we don't have access to the real one. But there are even cases where the application itself does not allow, the application does not allow itself to have a specific graph. For example, if the graph is dynamic, which is what happens in decentralized control problems where the network topology actually changes as the agents are moving, or because the graph is only partially available because it's a part of a large scale network that either due to computational or cost issues, we don't have access to all of it. So going back to the question that I asked in the beginning, motivated by sort of this discussion of trying to find the correct graph in the sense. So, you know, what happens if we train on the wrong graph? Or better yet, like more specifically, what happens if we train a neural network, a graph neural network using one graph, and then test on one on a different graph, right? Or by changing, by keeping the coefficient, freezing the coefficients, but using a different graph convolution, let's say. Now, in general, what happens? Who knows? Because if these graphs are completely random by each other, there's not much we can say. But in all the applications that I mentioned, one feature of them is that these graphs, they share certain types of structural properties, right? They are similar in a certain way that they look the same, even though they are different. And the way we're going to talk about looking the same is in terms of density of homomorphisms, right? So an homomorphism is just an embedding, let's say, of a graph, of a smaller graph that we'll call a motif into these larger graphs. And we'll just count essentially the proportion of these motifs that will appear in these graphs, right? They sort of, this density of homomorphisms sort of tell us what is the probability that neighborhoods of nodes look like that, right? And we will do that for different types of motifs. And this is exactly how we get from graphs to graphons, right? So the reason for that is because even though the definition of a graphon is simply a bounded symmetric kernel, so we can think of this as a continuous adjacency matrix, let's say, right? The reason why we care about this is because these are actually limit objects of increasing graphs that converge in density of homomorphism, which means that this limit object actually imposes a lot of structural properties on the graphs that come before. And depending on the graphon that we use, we'll see graphs that have different structural properties. This is one way of interpreting graphons, but graphons are also interesting because we can sort of revert that property by essentially looking at graphons as models for generating graphs, right? We can think of them as continuous stochastic block models, essentially. And by sampling graphs from the graphons, we obtain graphs that belong to this sequence, let's say, that share this property of having, of converging in this density of homomorphism. So graphs that look the same in the sense of having similar, let's say, properties, this property of density of homomorphism. Right. Given that we have this idea of graphon, we can do the exact same thing we did for graph convolutions with now with the graphon. So we'll define a graphon convolution by defining a linear operator based on the graphon, right? Which we will call the stride of our convolution. And that linear operator will define, that stride will define a new form of convolution, which is simply a aggregation of different applications of that linear operator to our input. Based on that, we can go through the exact same exercise again of building graphon neural networks by simply replacing the graph convolution by this graphon convolution. Now the input of the graphon neural network is a continuous signal, right? Rather than a sampled one. And the interesting thing here is that what we build in the end, this graphon neural network, is in a sense the limit object of a sequence of growing graph neural networks that converge in this, so that the graph of the convolutions converge in this density of homomorphism. And you know, the input signal converge in a sense in L2. We can make this definition formal. You can look at the paper by essentially working on this product topology between these two. Now, this idea that the graphon neural network comes as a limit object for these graph neural networks allows us to essentially go back to our question that we had in the beginning to graph neural networks as what happens when they go. Yes.
Sorry. The examples that you could, so the graphons are for the, you know, dense case, but the
exactly.
Examples that you gave don't seem to be the.
So some of them are so the recommendation system, that's a dense problem. The flocking is probably not, because that's, well, it depends a little bit on the communication region, but it's true that there are, essentially it's a nearest neighbor graph, so it's probably not. In the third example that I gave, the wireless communication one, that depends on the topology. It could be dense or it could not. That's actually one of the points in the end. That's a very good question. What happens in the sparse case? That's something that is ongoing work, definitely. But yeah, so we can go back essentially and use the graphon as a way to connect these graphs that we care about, right? About the training and the test. And what we do is simply say, well, we will say that we will compare the outputs of these neural networks, but we'll put them, essentially, we will connect them by saying that, you know, there are graph neural networks that converge to the same graphon neural network. Essentially, the graphs are sampled from the same graphon, and this gives us a way to control, the graphon gives us a way to control the structural properties of those graphs so that we can say something about them. The second thing that is interesting, if you remember, I mentioned that the graphon is is the limit object for graphs that converge in density of homomorphism. That gives us also a handle on spectral property of these graphs, right? Because if you think in terms of cycles, for example, right, density of homomorphisms in terms of cycles are essentially traces of the of powers of the adjacency matrix. So they give us sort of controls over the spectrum as well as controls over the properties of this. And these are the this type of results in terms of spectrum is what allows us to connect, let's say, smoothness properties of these limit objects to difference in the outputs between these networks. And that's exactly what we do in our result, where we connect the smoothness of the graphon and of the input signal, as well as the smoothness of the polynomials that are induced by the coefficients of the filters in the neural network, to differences in the output of two graph neural networks that essentially come from the same graphon family, right? And they can have different sizes, but we just care about the minimum sizes of the two of them. And essentially, this is the bound that we obtain. So I'll zoom in a little bit to explain a little bit where the different components come from. The first one is just a component that doesn't depend on the GNN at all. It's a component that depends on the input signal, the difference between the input signals of those neural networks. It goes to zero as we sample more from this continuous signal that we are assuming that we are sampling the inputs from. Now, the two other components, they depend directly on the architecture and on the parameters of the neural network. The first part here is a part that we call the transferable energy of the error, right? Because it's a part that goes to zero as the graphs grow, right? As the graphs that we are training and testing on become larger. It essentially depends on this, how smooth your graphon model is, which tells you, you know, how similar the graphs that you're going to sample from it are, and also how smooth the filters underlying the neural network actually are as well. The second term here is a part that we call the non-transferable energy, because it doesn't depend on the number of nodes of the graph. And we can actually trade off between these two types of errors by this bound parameter tau, which is essentially the bandwidth parameter, right? So it controls directly the non-transferable term by essentially determining what we are calling the non-transferable band, right? And it also affects the transferable energy through this discriminability parameter. So if you remember in the beginning, I was mentioning that these filters are going to, the role of the neural network is going to be to combine the different, you know, components of that are induced by the graph, these different features, right? And this is essentially a measure of how discriminable these features are, which is how many of them there are in the passband, but also how separated they are, right? So we can make tau, we can decrease tau to decrease the non-transferable energy, but at the potential cost of possibly, you know, increasing the transferable energy. Now, yes.
This is, when you say we can trade off, this is not something you do algorithmically.
No. The method is fixed. This is a proof. This is only from the proof.
So yeah. It's like holds for the infimum over tau.
Exactly. That's exactly where I was going now. So we could optimize this bound for tau, right? But this discriminability parameter depends on the graphon itself. So it depends on spectral properties. So actually, you can optimize for tau, but it's a problem-specific guarantee that you give, right? Asymptotically, you can take tau to zero and remove this bound, but the rate at which you should do that depends on spectral properties of the graph. That's a very good question. Thank you. Okay, so I'll just wrap up since this very short, quick ride throughout a lot of things. I tried to give you an idea of where graph neural networks come from as generalization of convolutional neural networks for this sort of network applications, right? And the question that we had to ask was, you know, what happens if we train the graph neural network on a different graph than the one that we test in practice, right? But in order to answer that question, we essentially built limit objects of these graph convolutions and graph neural networks, which were the graphon convolution and graphon neural network, and got this result that tells us that, you know, GNNs are transferable between different graphs in practice and in training, as long as, you know, the graphs are large enough, the spectral features are well separated for the feature test that you have, which will also make the GNN filters being less sharp because they need to separate between less complicated features. And a question that we have been working on is the one that actually Peter asked in the beginning, which is, you know, graphons, they're actually good models for dense graphs, right? Because they are node exchangeable models for node exchangeable graph. So what can we say in the sparse case? Essentially, this is a question that, can we do better in that case or worse? And what are the properties as well, like this tau, this bandwidth property that actually tell us how to control the error in that case? If you want to know more, there is a new paper from last year about this that you can check out or go directly to my website or Luana's website, which who is actually the lead on this project. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have time for maybe one or two questions while the next speaker sets up.
Are they different discretization of the
graphon? So Y1 and Y2 are the outputs of the filters to, because they might have different sizes, they are essentially zero order interpolations. So that norm is in L2. So they're for different discretizations of the same signal, but processed through different methods.
Does it allow you to do random sampling from the graphon?
You can do random sampling from the deterministic graphon. No, you can do it. This is the new work that actually Luana is doing today. I didn't talk about it, but you actually get a slightly better rate even in that case. Because the output have different sizes, but this is not, they are not related to the graphon themselves, just the graphs, not the output. So the input is just sampled in L2, so that's not the problem there. You can match them. They will converge anyway as long as you take more samples. It's doable. But it's not what I talked about today, for sure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Let's thank Luiz again. So, next talk is by Spencer Frey on self-training. Converts weak learning to strong learners.